Good day, and welcome to this video lecture on the autonomic nervous system. As the name implies, this is the branch of the peripheral nervous system that is, at least for the most part, automated or under subconscious control. It is responsible for the regulation of such things as blood pressure, heart rate, digestion, state of arousal, and sexual drive, and primarily acts through the contraction and relaxation of smooth muscle tissue surrounding tubes within the body and the stimulation of specific glands. The autonomic nervous system can be further divided into sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, which each have distinct structural and functional differences. The sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems are for the most part antagonistic, having something of a yin-yang relationship, meaning that a common function of each is to downregulate the other. Under normal physiological conditions, the parasympathetic nervous system dominates, and this is often nicknamed the rest and digest division of the autonomic nervous system. It serves to lower heart rate and blood pressure, increase digestive enzyme secretions, and promote peristalsic contraction in the alimentary canal in order to move food along through the digestive tract. In the clips that were shown at the start of the video, it reflects the state that the individuals were initially in while playing the maze game on their computers. The sympathetic nervous system takes over when we are confronted with a threat or challenge, or in anticipation of physical exertion. You ever notice that before the start of a race or important sports match that your heart's already racing and breath is coming quicker and deeper? This is known as anticipatory rise and is the body's way of priming your system for exertion through the sympathetic nervous system. Unfortunately, it can also become activated during stressful times when you'd prefer that the parasympathetic nervous system was in control.
Jo?
Yes?
I just wondered if you... maybe you want to go to the ball with me?
Sorry, I didn't catch that.
The sympathetic nervous system also kicks into gear when we become startled, as we saw in these clips of people whose friends suck or who should probably be taken away from their parents by child services. It provides us with a survival advantage when presented with a sudden danger, priming the body for action while we are still trying to consciously process the nature of the threat. As a result, the body is almost instantaneously prepared to defend itself from the danger that's imposed or to flee the area and generate a distance from the threat. Now, this is the reason that the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system is quite commonly referred to, in layman's terms, as the fight or flight response. Before we can look at the specific anatomical structures for the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, we need to first address a general structure for each system. First, let's review the somatic motor system. Now, if you remember, voluntary motor control is driven by the alpha motor neurons that innervate skeletal muscle. The cell bodies are found in the ventral horn of the spinal cord. The axons project out through the ventral roots, entering the spinal nerves, and projecting to their final destination on the membranes of skeletal muscle fibers. So for the somatic motor system, we have a single axon that projects from the lower motor neuron cell body found in the spinal cord to the effector organ, in this case skeletal muscle. In contrast, the autonomic motor nervous system is comprised of two lower motor neurons in series, where the axon of the first motor neuron projects from the central nervous system and synapses upon the cell body for the second motor neuron in series. These cell bodies for the second motor neuron are typically found in clusters known as ganglia. Consequently, the first motor neuron in the series is commonly referred to as the preganglionic, or also the presynaptic motor neuron, while the second motor neuron in the series is known as the postganglionic or postsynaptic motor neuron. When comparing the pre- and postsynaptic motor neurons for the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, we notice that the preganglionic axon is relatively short in the sympathetic nervous system, with the sympathetic ganglia located relatively close to the vertebral column. In contrast, the postsynaptic axons are generally longer, coursing through nerve tracts to their effector organs. The opposite is seen for the parasympathetic nervous system. The presynaptic axons are relatively long, projecting from the central nervous system to ganglia found close to or even embedded within the effector organs. The postsynaptic axons then take a very short path in order to synapse upon the effector organ. Another large difference between the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems are the specific location of these nerve tracts. In the sympathetic nervous system, presynaptic cell bodies are located in the lateral horns found between cord levels T1 through L2 of the spinal cord, which has led to the coining of the term thoracolumbar division to describe the sympathetic nervous system. In all instances, the presynaptic axons exit the spinal cord through the ventral roots to briefly enter spinal nerves T1 through L2. From here, they almost immediately project forward through small nerve projections referred to as white rami communicants to enter a long string of interconnected sympathetic ganglia found along the vertebral bodies. For this reason, these bilateral strings are referred to as the paravertebral or sympathetic chains. From here, a number of things can happen, and this will be the focus of the second segment of the video lecture. Generally speaking, however, postganglionic axons will exit the sympathetic chain and re-enter the spinal nerves through gray rami communicants to project to the skin and muscles of the body walls and appendages. In the case of the head, neck, and abdominal pelvic organs, there are varying paths that can be taken, but generally speaking, these nerve paths will typically be found running alongside the arteries providing the vascular supply to a given region. The parasympathetic nervous system is sometimes referred to as the craniosacral division of the autonomic nervous system due to the fact that parasympathetic nerve tracts are restricted to 4 of the 12 cranial nerves and the 2nd through 4th sacral nerves. For the cranial outflow, presynaptic cell bodies are localized to clusters within the brainstem called nuclei. The axons project through 1 of 4 cranial nerves to ganglia containing the postsynaptic cell bodies close to the effector organs, where they synapse. Postganglionic axons then complete the journey to effector organs in the head, neck, thorax, and foregut and midgut regions of the abdomen. For the sacral outflow, presynaptic cell bodies are localized to the sacral parasympathetic nucleus found in the gray matter of the spinal cord between the 2nd and 4th sacral cord levels. Presynaptic axons pass into spinal nerves S2, 3, and 4 to reach the hindgut and genitopelvic organs. They typically synapse with postsynaptic cell bodies found embedded in the target organ, and the postsynaptic axons project to synapse on the effector cells to complete the route. Well, that's going to do it for this overview of the autonomic nervous system. In the next session, we'll take an in-depth look at the sympathetic nervous system and the associated anatomical structures related to it. We'll see you then.